Good afternoon and welcome. If you are not finished with your food, we don't want to stop you, but I just want to start our luncheon date and would like to go through some of the things we are going to be doing here. Before I start, I would like you to meet some of our corporate leaders from Amarillo who have come here for this seminar. Our keynote speaker, Mr. Don Powell, is here. Dr. Russell Long, President of West Texas A&M University. Mr. John Marmaduke, Hastings Entertainment Incorporated. Mr. Michael Baum, Executive Director, AETC Amarillo. And then my good friend and colleague, distinguished scholar, world scholar in international marketing, Masaki Kotabe. He's over there from UT Austin. But he's going to divorce UT Austin and he's moving to Temple University in 3 days. And then we have Bob Wilkinson from Conseco Mortgage. And then Mr. Michael Callahan, CEO, Northwest Texas Healthcare System. And of course, in addition to that, we have some other leaders, and you will meet them at 1:50. We have a CEO session. But before I ask Dr. Long to introduce our keynote speaker, we would like to recognize our sponsors. Without their help, this seminar, there was no way we could have done it. At this time, I would like to invite and introduce you to some of our sponsors. Advanced Display Systems, Mr. James Lapino. I would request if you could come forward. We have something for you in order to appreciate your help. We have a certificate for you, for your cooperation. For Patel, Pentax, Joe Gantos. Patel is a Columbus, Ohio-based company, but they have sponsored this seminar. Mr. Gantos is representing Patel. Mashuk Chaudhry is one of our students. He graduated in 1990. He has done so well. He is one of the few entrepreneurs. And Mashuk has started a company, New Horizon Physician Practice Management. And I think he has opened offices in Dallas and College Station. We are really proud of Mashuk. And he's also one of the sponsors. Mashuk. And then, of course, Northwest Texas Healthcare System, Michael Callahan, CEO. Thank you for your help. JJ is not here. JJ represents Plains National Bank in Katy, Texas. I don't see JJ. I'll send this certificate to him. Amarillo National Bank is also not here. They were busy. They also sponsored this program. And then Morgan Stanley, Dean Witter, out of Amarillo, they sponsored this program and they couldn't send a representative, but I'll make sure they get it. And of course, Deepo Phoenix College of Business sponsored this program. Dr. Jerry Miller is in Russia, and he will be back, I think, tomorrow or day after tomorrow. And West Texas A&M University's bookstore, they also sponsored this program. Now, one thing I forgot, one person I forgot, I would like you to meet our new dean. He will be starting next week, Mr. John Cooley. He's over there. So, the purpose of this seminar was to understand all the alliances and joint ventures. It's not a fad anymore. It's a reality. There are thousands of alliances created in almost every life, every walk of life. It's no longer restricted to the business world. And our keynote speaker for this session is Mr. Don Powell. I would invite Dr. Russell Long to invite to introduce Mr. Don Powell. Dr. Long.
Thank you very much, Don Warren. Certainly, I want to welcome all of you to our campus here today. I think this is not only a very appropriate but a very, very timely subject. I know that all of you are far more sophisticated and far more knowledgeable about this than I am. But even at the university level, we have become far more aggressive in seeking out relationships in ways that universities traditionally had not done. And we have been somewhat successful at this. I'm very pleased with the successes that we've had. And I look forward to other opportunities to form public-private partnerships in the future. I really think this is the wave of the future for all of higher education, and particularly for public education. But you're not here to listen to me tell you how little I know about this subject. You're here today to listen to authoritative voices speak on this subject. And we're very fortunate to have with us today Mr. Don Powell, who has, as I think all of you know, an exemplary record in the private sector and in banking. Now, I have to admit that I know Don best in his role as my boss. As the chairman of the A&M System Board of Regents, he is responsible not only for the 10 universities in the A&M system, but also the state, the eight state agencies, ranging from the agriculture experiment research agencies, Texas Forest Service, Texas Transportation Institute, and so forth. And I am sure that he knew exactly what he was getting into when he was elected chairman of the board. I will only say about this that his hair was brown and he was 2 inches taller when this happened about a year ago. Don, we're delighted to have you with us today. We're extremely pleased of your position in the A&M system, and we're especially pleased that you are one of WD's own graduates. Thank you, sir.
Marmaduke, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Incident, you were introduced a moment ago.
I have a talent for that. I always take the next at the wrong time.
Well, I subbed for you and told them that I know that you would want me to give everybody today at this luncheon a $25 gift certificate. So we'll pick them up at the I'm delighted to be here, and if it's okay, I'd like to get behind, rather behind this podium. I've always wanted to be a preacher, and every time I'm behind one of those things, I tend to preach rather than talk. And so if you can't hear me, we'll speak up back there. But I'm so excited. I was telling Max, I said, I was had my radio on when I was coming to campus, and Mr. Warren, we're all anticipating Bell's announcement. Hopefully Emerald is there. If not, there's another deal, and et cetera, and so forth. But let me tell you something. I'm not even sure you know about this. I just can't put it off. Perhaps you know about a new industry that's coming to Amarillo, coming into Amarillo Pacific. This is exciting stuff. It's an industry that will have an annual budget of $58 billion, an annual payroll of approximately $30 billion, 760 full-time employees, 6,000 plus or minus part-time employees. It is recession-proof. It is environmentally pure, and they're going to make that announcement this afternoon. And what I just described to you folks is West Texas A&M University. Now, I did that because every time I go, and Russell's heard me do this before, I think we take West Texas A&M University for granted sometimes. I know we do in that whole business. Don't let me repeat those numbers again. Michael, I don't know what that would be worth to a community, but to have an annual payroll of approximately $30 million, an annual budget of $58 million, 700 and some odd full-time equivalents, of which, most of that's back to 6,000. those students spend money. That's a powerful, powerful economic engine. It runs 12 months a year, 24 hours a day. So I'm delighted that to be on campus, and I too would echo what Dr. Wong said. I think this private-public partnership, in fact, is a strategic alliance within itself. I think it's important that we remember that. It's important that each of us who live in Amarillo, some of you that do not live in Amarillo, support West Texas A&M University in all of its efforts. You know, a lot of, I don't have to repeat this, but you know what A&M means, that's what West Texas means to Amarillo Independent School District, to the A&M Independent School District, to the arts in this community. It's a tremendous educational institution, and we're delighted to be here, Dr. Wong. I'm delighted to be proud that West Texas is part of the A&M system. I will tell you that West Texas shines within the A&M system. West Texas, one thing that when we were talking about my fellow regents, you know, there's really nothing bad comes out of West Texas, like perhaps some of the other schools. You never read about West Texas in the newspaper max about the state of Austin being up here for 5 days. You never read about, in fact, I think we have something like 88 civil suits pending within the system. Two of those from West Texas and University. We have one. One from West Texas State University. I mean, it's a star within the crown of the system. We need to support that West Texas State. It occurred to me that I might say some of the things that most of these people have said this morning. In fact, I mentioned at the table that, you know, this business of outsourcing, the industry of outsourcing really is a result of joint ventures, affiliation agreements, and etc. So forth. But what I want to do is share with you really today a little bit of a case study, if that's okay. A recent experience as it relates to an affiliation agreement, a strategic initiative. It's in higher education. Most of my initiatives are in the business world. And I can tell you in the business world, you folks have written a book about how to deal with partnerships, joint ventures, affiliation agreements, alliances, whatever you want to call them. But you know as much about that as I do. But I'm going to share with you just a recent experience and share with you some lessons, very valuable lessons that I learned as it relates to the affiliation agreement. So pardon me for this personal experience, but I think there's some lessons here that can be learned. When I think about affiliation agreements, I think about five critical areas, especially as it relates to international. The first area I think about is how do we settle a civil dispute. I think that's critically important because you need to anticipate in any kind of type of an agreement that there's going to be some differences of opinion, or we can't spell out in an agreement everything that's going to happen. So there's going to be some differences of opinion. How do you settle with a civil dispute? I think that's critically important when you're doing business outside of the federal court system. You're doing business internationally, South America, wherever you make your business. How are you going to settle a civil dispute? Second issue, obviously, is the political constraints associated with whatever may be happening. It occurred to me that most of the deals that I've been involved in, that we failed to really address that. We address economics. It's all driven by economics because I think basically joint venture agreement, affiliation agreement is an admission by the entity that they cannot do what they want to accomplish by themselves. So they join a partner, outsource it, however they want to do it. That in the end, they're going to accomplish their goals by using someone else's talent. So we talk a lot about the economics. Are we going to make a buck out of this? But the political and the social, really something we don't think very much about. I was talking with Dr. McDonald earlier. Can you see the Packers and the Cavalry getting together in a division? They hate each other's guts. And yet, if they could get together, the economic benefit to both of those opponents would be outstanding. Can you see the First National Bank of Amarillo and Amarillo National Bank getting together? I promise you there's some things we could do that would benefit both institutions. So we must recognize that it's more than just economics, even though most agreements are driven by economic interest. Too many things get into the way. So, civil disputes, political, culture, disputes, economics, an exit strategy. I think that's something we don't talk very much about either. How do we get out of this particular problem? We're so excited about getting into this agreement. How are we going to get out? How are we going to get out of this particular? So I think those are five things that I was thinking about. Let me just briefly share, and I'll not be long, about an affiliation agreement that Texas A&M University attempted to do. We're still in the process of attempting to do. Texas A&M University College Station, we believe, is an outstanding academic institution. It lacks several things, one of which is legal education. There's not a law school affiliated with Texas A&M University. All of the 10 schools that are recognized universally as having as being the top 10 public institutions, there's only one that does not have a law school affiliated. So what legal education is extremely important. Obviously you've got money constraints. You know, the Texas legislature doesn't send that money out and say, we're going to start a law school. Then you have political constraints, you have social constraints. If in fact you want to do it, where are you going to put it? You know, let's put it in Canyon, Texas. That's what I told them. Let's put it in a law school in Canyon, Texas. It's some of the same conversation that occurred when the pharmacy school appeared in the area in Amarillo. I mean, why Amarillo? You know, if we need a pharmacy school, why Amarillo instead of school? But in order to benefit the people of Texas and our fiduciary role in attempting to explain why we thought that legal education was important to the rest of the Texas A&M University, if in fact we could benefit students at no cost to the taxpayer and not create a law school, it was a win-win situation for everybody. I mean, if in fact we could affiliate with an existing private institution, just affiliate at no cost to the taxpayers, we were not creating another law school, we were not creating more lawyers. I mean, that's a win-win for students, it's a win-win for people of Texas, it's a win-win for the taxpayers. Now, I'd like to stay here and let you tell me why that's a bad deal. Well, it ain't there. It's not even close. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of those culture, the social issues that I'm going to explain to you in just a moment that we fail to perhaps recognize or do not appreciate. Again, economically, very simple. No increase tax rate. You're not going to have to pay one dime for this. We're not creating another law school. No money being spent. Students have benefited from it. It's a wonderful deal. South Texas College of Law was recognized as an outstanding law school at zero debt, $47 million in assets, of which $28 million was cash. I could even understand that. You know, so we're not going to assume any bond debt. We were not going to assume any contingent debt. They were freestanding, doing well. Why did they need Texas A&M? Well, we think it was perhaps pretty obvious the reason they would like to have Texas A&M. And I've just told you why Texas A&M wanted to affiliate with South Texas College of Law. One of the things I talked about at the table we could talk about here is that we had a presence in Houston, Texas. If you look at the A&M system, we're big in towns, but we're not big in cities. So we would have a presence in the second and third largest city in America. That's wonderful. That's not a bad deal. At no cost to taxpayers. No cost to taxpayers. Okay, so when we began to start to deliberate, first of all, there were 15 lawyers in the room, and a dumb guy like me and some of my associates, and we were outnumbered anyway. So we were at a disadvantage because they were bright. I was there, but we talked about we had to have some common objectives. Okay? And the common objectives were three. That's the way an affiliation agreement goes. You gotta have common objectives. We wanted to benefit students. If this was going to hurt students in any way, it's going to go for it. It's going to cost students any more money, it's going to increase tuition. Are we really going to benefit students? And they were enormous how we felt that students could be benefited. And I think you can see that on our board closely. The second thing is that we recognize that we must receive approval by the body that oversees our actions. By the Bar Association, American Bar Association, and us by the coordinating board. Okay, and then we had independent objectives. And could we blend those two objectives together? They had one criteria, remain independent and private. If it looked like a public entity, if it felt like a public entity, no dice. They didn't want to have anything to do with it. They wanted to remain independent, and they wanted to remain public. We had five objectives over here, basically. I think I can remember all Number one was control. Are we going to put our name on an institution without control? In your business venture, Marmaduke, are you going to put Hastings' name on something you don't have any control over, even if it's a good history? Don't want to do that. But you got, there's a lot of give and take in these negotiations, just like they're in the history. So really that name belongs to the big Texas, and we understood that. So what control features would we have in academic excellence, financial matters, faculty, curriculum, all those things? Would we have admissions? Would we have anything to say about it? So again, in a business deal, there's lots of things that you're talking about under that control factor. Brand name, simple things like hours of operations. Who gets to hire the people, who fires the people, who's going to be running this division, who's going to be running it when you're gone, and so on and so forth. Very important. You can't think of all the things. And the second thing is legal. Is it legal for us to do that? Again, that's part of the dispute that's not along with us. We're having a lawsuit over it right now. We believe, I mean, that was a fact issue. But it's not a fact issue. I mean, it's in the courts. So you got to remember everything that you're doing, if you're in a regulated industry, have the regulators blessed it? Is it legal? What are you going to do if you get to the chief? We believed it was legal. Their side believed it was legal. At the same time, what type of liability that are you going to incur as you get into this affiliation? Many times in business, I can have an affiliation with patients. And if I don't pay attention and look at their balance sheet, look at things off the balance sheet, look at all the things that the normal due diligence should bring up to the bottom of the water, I'm in trouble, because what I've really done is assume that I changed my balance sheet because I've taken on the liability of patients. So did we have any liability? Was there any contingent liability that we would put the people of Texas at risk of? That gets back to the control factor. Because that particular institution is governed by a board of directors. When we negotiated, you know, I said, well, if we can't have as many directors on your board that we're appointing as you do, it's no deal. And the lawyer said, you don't want equal representation. Because the reason you don't want equal representation, because in fact, then it becomes a public entity versus a private. So you're putting the people in Texas at risk when you become a public entity. We didn't want to become a public entity. So what? From what I'm reading, I share that with you. What perceived as a control issue, really, if we got control, then we assume some liability. So you may want control in your joint venture, or you may want control in the affiliation agreement. But with that control comes accountability and responsibility, and perhaps financial liability. So there's a lot of things you got to think about. Exit strategy doesn't work. How do we get out? It doesn't cost you. We just, at our bank, put on notice the people who supply our data processing to us. The contract expires 3 years from now. That was an agreement for 3 years ago. They were outsourcing the workforce. It's going to cost us $225,000 to get out. I tried like the devil, not the devil. Again, if you want to get out of this affiliation agreement, what's it going to cost you? Not only what is it going to cost you economically, what is it going to cost you politically, what is it going to cost you culturally? You're going to have some scars. Because I think the marketplace is pure. I always say that. And if you, for some reason, had a divorce with an agreement, why? I'm suspicious of you when you want to have an agreement. I want to know a lot of the reasons why you, in fact, divorced yourself from that particular agreement. So you've got to have an exit strategy. It really needs to be pretty crisp, clear, distinct, where you get out of it. And that's lots of negotiation. It's just not economics. It's more than just economics. And then the liability, you know, what increase in liability? I talked a little bit about that you're going to have as you get into this particular agreement. But the thing that I believe that kills more affiliation agreements and strategic initiatives than anything else is this culture and political issue. And you can talk, you can call it any way, anything you want. But it's basically, do I want to spend the rest of my life with that woman? It's the same type of question. Now, you said we negotiate the Nexus strategy, we negotiate all the potential items, etc. That's the very reason the packer and the cattleman can't get together. That's the very reason I can't get together with certain things. So you really need to, not kid yourself about those issues. What we failed to do in this particular location, we didn't do a very good job, is that we didn't do our due diligence and homework in dealing with the coordinating board with the members of the legislature. It was obvious it was a good deal for us. I mean, anybody could see it was a good deal. They weren't looking at it. But we failed and we didn't give enough credit. Guess what the University of Houston bought? You think they like it? Guess what the Texas Tech Law School bought? Texas Tech Law School would say, oh, we don't care, we don't have a dog in the fight, it's okay with us. And then they would say, probably, I don't like it. Why don't they like it? A student at West Texas A&M, guess where he or she's going to go to law school? I think they would go to South Texas, all things equal, versus Texas Tech or University of Texas. We failed to recognize the political influence of some of these other entities. And then we failed to recognize, even though we mentioned that I was helping people charge it from the brain and the heart, we failed to do the work we should have done before that. Again, as Houston Chronicle pointed out, it's not a matter of the merits of the city of the particular case. It's a matter of the process in which we attempted to sell it to the coordinator. So you can have all types of economically sound affiliation and forget about those two components. Either it's a shareholder problem. Cheryl said, what you guys doing that for? I think it's the dumbest thing I've ever heard you do. You didn't sell it properly, or you didn't fail to anticipate that. Maybe a regulator problem. It may be a fellow worker problem. Maybe a board of director problem. You failed to sell it to your board of directors. I mean, it was obvious to you, but it wasn't obvious to them. Those two components are critical. In my opinion, in dealing with affiliation agreements and strategic alliances. I mean, they just are, they break down. Some people are just not meant to be married. Even though they look good together, they're just not. And if you fail to ignore those two components, it gets you in a heap of trouble. I'm delighted to be here. I again apologize for that personal deal, but I think those 5 years that we talked about, again, a common interest. You got to have a common economic interest. We'll talk about those 4 or 5 issues. But I'm going to emphasize one more thing. It's not the economics that usually kills business. Because that's what you get for. It's culture and political issues that kill it. I was just talking about the cattle industry. You know, you guys, if you could get together with the packer, you both win. But you hate each other's guts. I'm delighted to be here. And I'm sorry I missed this morning's session, but again, congratulations on the session. And remember about that big industry that's coming to town. Thank you.
Mr. Ball, thank you for your excellent comments. On behalf of the continuing education, we would like to present you this small token of our appreciation, a small certificate. I was introducing all the business leaders. Mr. Paul Inver just came in. He's the CEO of Campus Feeders. He's over there. And he will be part of our CEO session. It was a great session. Thank you for your excellent comments, observations, and we really enjoyed it. Our third session will start at 1:15, so we have a 15 minutes break. Thank you again, and I would like you to attend our third session. Thanks.